with my buddies on a podcast. A podcast.
Oh, I'm so used to singing and then you talk.
Yeah.
I think we should be quiet for longer.
It's throwing me for a loop.
Enough of a pause.
That's fine. I think I like historically people on the we edge sing of their seats.
And then you talk, but now we sing and then I talk.
It does feel weird to not be like Mary. Mm-hmm. I don't remember it sounding like that.
Mary, Mary,
no. That is what it sounded like.
Yeah, no, that's my memory of it. It's just like
Mary, 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 girl.
So far, this is a good podcast. My name is Jordan, and you are a listener who has joined us. Welcome. Here at Two Chunks and a Hunk, which is a podcast about everything good and nothing bad. That's a guarantee. Everything 100%. Here, everything here has been vetted by a team of, vetted. I assume, veterans. I don't know how vetting works, yeah. But everything
veterinarians,
here,
I think.
Everything yes. here has been vetted by correct. A team of veterinarians who are committed to providing you with quality listening material about everything good and nothing bad. I'm Jordan once again.
I'm Doge, and I think it's important to keep in mind that there are always new places to go fishing. For any fisherman, there's always a new place. Always a new horizon.
So we're still doing
and
that?
And that's a quote from Jack Nicklaus. I just want to keep us inspired. I want the muse to alight on our shoulders.
That was Jack Nicklaus?
It's different. That's Jack Nicklaus, yeah.
Wow.
From The Shining.
The one and only. The one and only. I'm Carter.
Here's golf.
Golf, love of my life. And I'm Carter, and may the knife chunk and shatter. That's a Paul Atreides quote. From Dune Pardue.
Dune Pardue.
Dune Pardue.
Figured at the jump here.
Dune Dune.
Dune Dune.
Boom, 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 boom,
boom. I love On Order.
Dun, dun, bum, 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 bum.
How much does that intro slap though? That
bam, it's a bop. Bam, bam, bam,
bam, bam. Dun, bum, bum.
Bro, that used to shake my bones when I was a kid. I was like, this is the best thing ever.
Did you hear about the new like creatures that they're adding in Dune Part 2 in addition to the giant sandworms?
I'm so excited to hear about them.
There's going to be a pack
I can't wait.
There's going to be a pack of dick wolves.
Oh man, it's either gonna be really creative Denis Villeneuve Frank Herbert designs here for our dick wolves, or they're just gonna be like, oh, what's up, Paul? What you doing today? Like, they're just like real jerks.
Oh, this guy thinks he's good at saving people.
Where your friend Idaho? Where Duncan be?
No, they'd be like, what was that guy Idaho's first name? And then he'd be like, what do you mean? And then they'd be like, Duncan. And then they'd dunk on him. Yeah.
Yeah, they're that's like what the dick
one of them's asking, and the other one's behind him, like with the hoop. I'm like, yeah,
yeah, for sure.
Boom.
For oh my sure.
I'm imagining them as cartoons.
It's yes,
like Dune Part 2 becomes like a sleeper sequel to that Paula Abdul music video. And they're the also cat? 2D cartoon wolves.
I love that. I like to imagine that somebody has no idea what that's a reference to and is like, why are they talking about this?
It's out of nowhere.
Why are they talking about
sorry,
who
bro.
Who brought up Paula Abdul and Dick Wolf?
That's just for my dickheads out there.
They've never been in the same sentence before.
Y'all know who you are.
My dick.
Where my long order people at? We bring up Dune Part 2 because here at the beginning of this, it's not the beginning anymore because of that awesome riff that we just had. We are going to introduce a new club to the mix because we know that if you're not a member of a club, you're not. So,
dang.
On three, do we want to tell them the name of the new club? As we're like perfectly synced on our podcast recording devices, Would it hold some gravitas if we all said it at the same time? We don't have to sing it. We just say it at the same time.
I can't see a way in which that's worse than just one of us talking.
Great.
So let's do it.
Okay. So introducing for the first time this year, first time ever, the
Two Chunks Movie Club.
Wow.
That was the exact same energy and inflection as
Origel Training Toothpaste.
It was. Wow.
The Two Chunks Movie Little Bear, Club. I got your toothpaste. The Two Chunks Movie Club was created, A, because we want to keep seeing movies with you guys. Last year, we really got to do that. We did that with Barbenheimer. And a couple of other flicks. And that's just, it's just a wonderful experience.
It's just
and we
good.
Want to spend some more time with you, the listener. And then also, we want to have some opportunities for those of you that have Patreon to vote more. I know you're eager in this 2024 season to get those voting fingers working. You know, get them limber. Because there's a lot of voting
practice
this year.
Practice for November.
Yeah. Yeah. Get them limber. Practice for November. Join the Two Chunks Movie Club.
Wow.
That was not me. That was Jordan TM. Did it. Yeah.
TM.
TC. The TCMC. And how this is going to work is most months, we're going to identify 3 to 4 movies, introduce those on the podcast. You've probably had heard of them if you've got your ear to the ground of like new movie releases for a certain month. And then that will open up a vote that will last most often like over an entire month to decide which of these movies that we're going to see all together for the next month. And it can be, you know, any of these 4 movies. I will try and make sure that it's a bit more of a scatter plot, that it's not all just 4 things that we want to see. Because I know that September, October, November is going to come up and there's going to be some scaries out there. I promise we won't avoid that. Really, what I'm going to try and do is give us the top 4 with the most hype for that month, and then y'all vote on what we see. We didn't need to vote, though.
Although
that might happen sometimes.
Scary, I'm going to get food poisoning on purpose that day.
Yeah, it works. Just
we need a doctor's note.
Yeah,
that's it.
I have diarrhea. Probably. I can't see this movie.
Give me a few months, and I can give you a doctor's note.
Nice.
You know what I'm saying? That's really why I'm doing it. For March, we don't need to have a vote. Because we need to see Dune Part 2.
It's obvious.
It's obvious. So
it's obvious.
We will release like where we're going in our Patreon. Do we also want to put that? We can cut this out. Do we want to put that on the social medias too? To just the more the merrier?
It's only for patrons. Leave it in the episode. Sorry, they need to know that if they're not a patron, then they don't get to do it.
It's for patrons, y'all. For patrons. It's for that $5 tier. If you want to get in there into the Discord and join the other chunkies, that's where we're going to be releasing where we'll be going to see Dune Part 2.
Dune 2's coming out. Should we also project it on the side of the building so people can just walk by and watch it for free? No.
You wouldn't download a car.
Can't download a car. Can't do that.
You can't download a car.
But
I would if I could.
I would.
TCMC. Be on the lookout.
That's going to be hard. That's almost too many letters. TCMC.
TCMC?
TCMC.
Mm. Yeah.
TCMC.
Turner Classic Movies.
It works. Charles. It's fine.
I think the shortening, like the a fun way to say it is like it's Teach Meech.
The Teach Meech.
Teach Meech. I'm a member of the Teach Meech.
That's fine.
I like it. Yeah, but be on the lookout for that.
You conjured the specter of Barbenheimer just a second ago.
I did.
Is it worth, should we tell folks about there's a second Barbenheimer this year and there's a third Barbenheimer that I don't even know if you guys know about yet.
I don't know the third one.
There's a third Barbenheimer. We have talked in person about the second Barbenheimer this year. Do we talk about that now or do we save that?
I don't mind talking about it.
Save it for when we inevitably decide that that's a stupid idea and we don't want to do it.
It's a great idea, but it's going to stay in our back pocket. It's going to mature a little bit. It's like blue cheese. It's got to get a little stinkier, then people are going to love it.
So we're not sharing? Man, I am such a bad secret keeper. I'm not going
to
say anything.
We won't talk about the second one. Can I talk about the third one, though? Because that's interesting to me.
Do it. It's this year?
The third Barbenheimer. Yes, there's a third Barbenheimer this year, and it's this fall with the surprise announcement of Moana 2.
Oh, yeah.
It is releasing the same day as Wicked. So there's a wicked Moana Barbenheimer situation going on. And I called this last year. We talked about predictions for 2024. I was like, I think studios are going to try and release big movies, similar vibe or like similar cultural pull on the same day. And it's happening two more times this year.
Dude, what an interesting.
You look me in the eye and tell me that the second one is a similar cultural pull.
It's a similar cultural pull.
Wow, he looked
the second Barbenheimer is perhaps the most powerful Barbenheimer that we've seen up to this point. It puts the bomb in abomination.
I think it's basically like being like, there's a Chili's next to a 7-Eleven, so we should grab snacks from both.
You did not present.
Tell me
to
that
me a
sounds out
idea.
Of character. Yeah, tell me that sounds out of character.
It's
for
not.
The three of us.
It's not out of character. It's just nonsense.
Yeah,
yeah. That's fine. That's fine.
All of the
my
Wahlbergs
favorite moments for
agreed.
Doge are when he gets to be the off the wall guy. when Doge gets to grab these little moments where he's like, no, 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 no. I'm the crazy one. I'm the crazy one.
I'm not sure. Listen, if you think you can predict me, that's your own problem. That's maybe your own box that you've put your brain in, and I'm living out here outside of the box. So.
He out there.
To your point.
He out there.
While we're talking about sleeper surprise sequels, because Moana 2 is like a total shock to me. I know they're working on the live action version, and this doesn't replace the live action version. This is just the TV show. This was going to be a Disney Plus TV show that's now been retooled as a movie because Disney is just hemorrhaging money.
Dude, it makes me so sad that I am no longer in a place where I can be like, yes, please give me more of a good thing. And instead, when Disney's name is attached to it, my first thought is like, oh, they're just going to screw it up. Like, they're just going to make me retroactively hate Moana 1 more.
Do you feel like that with Inside Out 2?
A little nervous.
I do with Inside Out 2, for sure.
I'm excited because I think it will hopefully be good. Yeah. But I am a little nervous about it for similar reasons. I just don't. That makes sense. All my faith in Disney has gone. Like, all of it.
Yeah, that's fair.
Makes sense.
I thought while we were talking about surprise sequels, we might take a little ride on the Cellevator. That we rode on the Cellevator a few times, two different times. And both of them ended in death during the Shadowcast. But I want you guys to convince me. I'm a studio head. I run Dozny. Dozny. That's good, right? That's not Disney. That's Dozny. They can't sue me for that.
It's true. I like that.
And I am in the business of making surprise sequels to movies. Movies that don't necessarily demand a sequel. But we think folks might like a sequel for them. And so I need you guys to pitch to me, the studio head, a surprise sequel. The way the Cellevator works is I've got a random number generator right here. Generate a random number between 1 and 8. And that's the number of floors that you ride on the elevator with me, the studio head. You get one sentence per floor and you alternate sentences. Let's begin. I'll generate your number. Oh, you guys lucked out. This is a very tall tower. We're very wealthy over at Dozhny. It's 8 floors.
Oh,
you get 8 sentences. Alternate sentences back and forth. Pitch to me a surprise sequel that I didn't know was coming and get me excited about it.
Would you hold the door for us for just a second? Sorry.
Excuse us.
I appreciate it. Excuse us. We just want to... What floor are you going to?
I'm going to 8, all the way to the top. I'm playing a character named Whit Dozhny. And he's 100 years old. He was frozen cryogenically and he's just recently been thawed out.
Got it. Goodness.
He's from like the 30s.
Got it. Does he have any spicy takes on like world happenings or politics or anything
like
that?
He does not like several people groups, but you will never guess which ones.
We got 8 floors. We can find them. Let's just do that instead of pitching
8 floors. 8 floors is such a small tower. It's such a small tower. Okay.
It's the biggest tower that I saw at the Chicago World Fair in 1920.
Let me tell you what's interesting.
I built it out of wood and nails.
We're going to.
My God.
You built it. We're also going to the 8th floor. So just go ahead and hit that button.
What a coinky dink. Skinnamarinky.
Go ahead and hit that button.
I'm sorry.
Button,
you need me to push the button.
Go ahead and hit the button, old man.
Please. Wish you would.
That's fine.
Hit the button, you ancient mummy of a human.
Sorry about that. Your sentence count begins now.
Can I ask you something, old guy? Do you ever feel like what you bring to the table is good, but it's not just enough, and you wish you could unlock the latent power inside?
I think I'm supposed to say yes.
Well, we might have found a way, sir, to unlock this power exponentially.
Let me ask you a follow-up question. How do you feel about domestic animals, specifically clean ones?
Positively.
Excellent. How do you feel about grinding rails in suburban neighborhoods?
That sounds like something an adolescent would enjoy.
Become remembering why we didn't have the characters respond between every sentence.
It takes so long. Just listen, just start talking over him. He really can't hear you that well anyway. So just do your whole pitch.
Got it. I got two words for you, old guy.
Skate better.
I'll put it like this, comma. We believe that there is a demographic out there that you need to start catering to again.
You're losing quality, you're losing life, you're losing fans, and today is your chance to get them all back. Eric Von Detten isn't doing anything.
Well, we're almost just, to our floor.
Just talk over him, it's fine. And while Carter is talking, I'm gonna roll a stealth check as I sidle over to hit the emergency stop button on the elevator. It's a nat 20.
We think that Brink 2 can absolutely happen, and it can bring you lots of monies.
I unzip my jumpsuit to reveal a Team Puppin' Suds t-shirt, and that my pockets were full of puppies and kittens the entire time. I had really deep cargo pockets that had puppies and kittens, and I just start handing them one at a time to Dink Dojny or whatever his name was. I just start handing him.
Usually it's like a bomb or something. That no. Puppies and kittens is better for sure.
I haven't finished. I start handing him puppies.
He's allergic.
And kittens. does he take them from me as I hand them to him?
He says, thank you for the puppies and the kittens.
They're not for you. I just continue to pull, at this point, dozens of puppies and kittens from what seems to be like a bag of holding style pocket system. Just like a pocket.
Mary Poppins purse.
Yeah. I go for the back pocket that I thought he would forget and the one that I was most concerned about because there were little yelps earlier, and I just kind of like unzip that one too and just like point to it like, there, see, I told you to do that one.
And then as I pull the lever for the fire alarm, the elevator sprinklers begin to drop water on all of the kittens and puppies, which I had preloaded with dried powdered shampoo, and they start to froth and lather in his hands.
You got him. You pranked him really good.
He's now covered in pups and suds. And he'll never forget the elevator pitch. The best part, though, is that when he opens his eyes, we're gone.
I guess it was all a dream.
What would your honest reaction be to a Brink 2 announcement? If they're like, it's the most realistic version of a Brink 2 announcement would be, it's a show on Disney Plus about their kids.
So if it was a show on Disney Plus about their kids, boo, thumbs down. Who's this for? Because kids don't care about it. If it was a show made for the old audience of Brink in any way, shape, or form, in. But I feel like making a show for kids of people that used to like Brink is pointless because
is Brink 2? Like, if they make Disney it for adults, right now, what is it?
Disney Dude, it's right a new now hope. Is making it's exactly a new hope. Eric is basically the Obi-Wan character. That it's like this kid wants to
that's
skate.
What I'm saying. It'd have to be a generational, like a torch passing thing.
For sure, but I think making it a show for kids about Brink's kids is what Disney currently would do and not a good idea.
I think they would Cobra Kai it. I think it would totally be,
see, I think
here's these old mentor skaters. Yeah. That's fair.
I think that's way more interesting than making a kid show, is making a split show where half the show is about Brink and his friends as adults and the other half is about training the next generation of Team Puppetside Soul Skaters.
Yeah.
But I feel like Disney doesn't have the courage to do stupid things. They only have the accidental stumbling into stupid capabilities, which they keep doing. And if they were just stupid on purpose, a lot of these things would be great.
It's all, because it's all committee. It's all designed by committee. It's all like, let's minimize our potential losses, which is a great way to run Walmart. Maybe not a great way to run an entertainment company, you know?
Yeah. Disney just feels so sanitized to me right now.
Yeah. The way that there's like, oh man, they make shows all the time. They make movies all the time. Very often, like when these hypotheticals are brought up, I just choose to just look it up. Be like, is there going to be a Brink 2? I have a special surprise for y'all. As I look on the internet movie database. There was. It already happened. In 2011, a 23-minute short called Brink 2 Val's Revenge. What? It was an unofficial sequel to the Disney Channel original movie Brink. Years after losing a downhill race, Val decides to kidnap his former rival's sister and challenge him to a rematch.
So he's like a supervillain?
Something like that.
That's so sick.
There is... I'm looking right here. I'm doing a quick check. Let me check the logs. There is absolutely zero of the same returning cast, but there is a character called the Blade Whisperer. Ooh. So it sounds like I gotta watch this movie.
Ooh, where is it? Is it on YouTube?
How do you even find it, dude? Probably not. It feels like it's just a silly boy.
Gonna look real quick. Gonna look real quick. Gonna, what's it called? Brink 2 Val's Revenge?
Brink 2 Val's Revenge. See the whole thing right here on YouTube.
I got trailer.
Watch it with sound here, and there's a right here. Link. Got it. I'll copy
That's
paste this
crazy.
In the chat.
57,000 views.
How wild. See, everybody wants it.
That's all anybody wants.
All 57,000 people on the earth at this time want this movie.
That's crazy.
Probably going to watch it at some point.
Dude, there's no way.
No, it's going to be bad, but I'm excited about it.
Yeah. Oh, I'm going to watch this for sure. That's a ton of fun.
I can't believe we just stumbled into that.
Thank you, Doge.
I made it. I made Brink 2.
The other thing you made.
I was convinced by your elevator pitch.
Is a dollar.
Hmm.
Well, you will right now. Shout out to that.
Like
shout
we say every time.
That's how we do it. That's how we do it. Listen, I think it's really, really, really important that you pay attention right now, if no other time, because Two Chunks Movie Club, or Teach Meech, as a lot of people are saying.
Where's the second ch sound coming from?
Same place the first one is.
No, Chunks has a CH. But
it's not
club.
About the words, it's about the letters.
It should be Teach Meekle.
It's not about
Teach Meek.
It's we're pronouncing the acronym. We're not pronouncing the beginning of the words. We're pronouncing the acronym itself.
So then it should be Tick-Mick.
Well, that's if you're
I get how
closed-minded.
Be, but sometimes that's not how they are.
It should be Teach-Meek or Teach-Meekle.
Hey, wasn't it you merely 10 minutes ago talking about how off the rails and crazy you are? Let's not get pedantic here.
I'm a wild, like I can't be defined in a box,
when
really.
People ask me, they're like, of your friends, which one's just sort of the wild card, most
which one's
crazy
the craziest
friend? I'm like Doge every time, dude.
Every time.
It's Doge always.
Yeah. I'm unpredictable.
Teach Meech is going to be the best thing in your life because it's already the best thing in mine. So I can be confident when I tell you that you need to get on board. We are, we're going to get together once a month and we're going to go see a movie all as a community, as a group, as a group of friends, and we have loved both of the opportunities we've gotten to do that. And as we talked about the next year, one of the things we said is that's got to happen way, way more. So that's what we'll be doing. I'm really excited about it. It's so much fun to get everybody together. And first of all, just like have a group to see movies with, a group of people that love movies and just want to have a good time. But some of the most fun that I get to have at these is just like talking to everybody and catching up with old friends, meeting new people, and like catching up with people that we met at the last one. And I don't know, it's just it's a really cool community that I don't feel like there are many opportunities for me to like have that style of. And so being able to do it with people that want to talk about movies and hang out and, you know, grab a beer or whatever is just like the best. So make sure that you have access to Teach Meech by doing the thing that Doge is going to tell you to do. And listen to him.
You might be asking yourself, number one, shouldn't it be called Teach Meekle? And the answer is yes. And then you might also be asking yourself, how do I participate? You can vote for the movie that we will see as part of our monthly Teach Meekle gathering. If you're alive, if you are alive and have access to the internet, you get to vote for that.
Yeah.
If you would like to vote twice, that's available exclusively for our supporters on Patreon, either at the $3 a month or $5 a month level. If you want to know actually where we're going to the movie and come see it with us, that's on Discord. That's $5 a month. But we will be releasing an episode about these movies. So even if you don't support us on Discord, even if you just are a regular person, not somebody who loves us and is willing to put a dollar amount on that, if you're just listening to this and you just want to vote, your vote still counts and you could influence the movie that we see and talk about on the podcast. So if you love us, you might vote for, you know, a movie like Furiosa. And if you hate us, you might vote for Garfield. But either way, we have to go see the movie that you tell us about.
Yeah, we've got to go see it. And that's something that, you know, I'm glad we're mentioning here is that that does get reviewed on the podcast. So there will be that time that we go see it and you get to hear our opinions and our experiences.
That would be
seeing that movie.
An extremely unappealing thing to ask people to participate in. If it's like, hey, vote for this movie that other people get to go see with the podcast.
Yeah.
No matter what, you get something out of it.
If, you know, you've got all your streaming platforms, Hulu costs more now. You're getting bumped from all of these things that you were sharing with your parents, and now you've got to pay for your own. You don't have the $5 to find out exactly where we're going for watching our movies with you guys.
Get your bread up, dude.
Yeah, get your bread up. Yeah. Or, I mean, I can understand. I would feel this kind of like pull to just like pull out the map of all the theaters in the Metroplex and be like, I'm just going to take a shot at a specific time. If you're willing to do
that, that's fine with me, actually.
You just need to know that we kind of mix things up. We aren't always going to the same theater every time.
We're constantly scrambling our location to cover our digital
constantly
footprint.
Scrambling. And
there is no way for you to track us.
In that same spirit, you might have noticed that the way that we are navigating our podcast is switched up a little bit. One of the things that we talked about when we had our State of the Tunion, when the three of us got together to talk about
just the worst names for things, on this podcast.
I thought that was good. I like State of the Tunion. Sometimes I saw the joy in his eyes. I saw Jordan's joy.
I liked State of the Tunion a lot.
Is that starting this year, and you probably have already heard, starting with the first couple of episodes of this year, we're changing things up a little bit. You're going to get a little bit more of just pop culture in general or just us shooting the breeze because we decided that that's something that we enjoy. And honestly, in terms of feedback that we got from many of you, I think you would just, it doesn't necessarily have to be talking through a movie. The hope there is also that we can open up to a bigger audience that can just pick a random episode and listen and have some fun with us without feeling like they had to do some homework. So be on the lookout for that. We're having fun with it. We hope you do too.
Yeah, Two Chunks and a Hunk is taking a firm anti-homework stance for the year 2024.
Carter, how does that impact your career as
a professor? No different. Like, yeah, there's no homework.
Are you allowed to say that out loud?
Yeah.
That you're anti-homework?
It's no different than what I do already. Wow. We just kind of come in. And no matter what the subject is, we come in, bring our favorite snacks, and share them. That's all we do. Thanks, DBU, for paying me to have snacks with my friends.
I'm bringing a new bit to the table in 2024 that I want to try on for size.
Six bits.
I had a different name last night, but I changed it. It came to me in a dream. Does what I'm going to need you to do is in post.
Yeah.
Drop in a choo-choo train sound right here. welcome to the Hyperfixation Station, my favorite place on the planet. It's where all my interests align. And it's at a place that I like to call manic and obsessive. That's right. This is my bit where I get to talk about the things that I love, which either change or don't, dependent upon conceivably nothing at all.
This sound the like premise, the setups sounds like the intro to like a Inside Out style children's movie.
Yeah.
Like, welcome to Hyperfixation Station at the corner of manic and obsessive.
Well, yeah, that's pretty much it.
They're all going to start singing about trains of thought.
Oh gosh. And the pace gets faster and faster and faster.
It's just a bunch of little kids that are like, when I like something, I only like that thing. Bam, 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 bam. Everything else is stupid and I don't like that thing. Yeah, it's a very like, welcome to Duloc, like Oompa Loompa. It's a song of warning. It's not a song of happiness. It's a song of like, don't be like this.
Stay away.
Don't be like
travelers.
This.
Do not enter Hyperfixation Station. Yes. You will not leave.
I have this thing. I think a lot of people do. I tend to have it in ways that bother even me sometimes. But I have this thing where like when I like something, I'm just like, that's all I'm gonna like
now
for a while. And I just go so hard into the things that I like. And as I grow and age, it has caused me to be a little more discerning about the things I allow myself to get super into. Because if I get too into something that's like a 7, why would I waste all that time on a 7? Sometimes I just get so locked in. And in 2020, during lockdown, got really, really into, for the first time ever, Survivor. I had never watched it before. I decided to just jump in. I found a list online of like, start here and watch all these. And boy, howdy did we. It carried me through a lot of lockdown and even sort of post that time period. It was a big deal. And
Carter, was that a train whistle or was that the Survivor sound?
That was the Survivor sound.
Oh, could have been both.
Yeah. The train whistle mix.
It sounded like the Survivor sound. I thought it was
Survivor theme, parentheses, train whistle mix. Lo-fi, slow down for chill hop study, 3-hour repeat.
Featuring Zed. I got really into Survivor, which then led me to get really into Big Brother and then led me to get really into The Challenge. We watched Amazing Race. We just got really into competition. Yep. Reality has become like the last 4-ish years. We have just been devouring competition reality shows, old seasons, new seasons. We've tried shows that we didn't like. We've tried shows we thought we wouldn't like that we loved. But I have just developed this deep love for competition reality shows. I love the strategy. I love when people hit each other. I love when people are catty and mean. I like when they're best friends and stay friends out of the show. I love it all. It all hits for
all
me.
All juicy. Yeah. All the time, it's always juicy.
All juicy. And competition reality as a genre, if we could call it that, and I'm sure we would all agree here, is also, it's one of those things to where if you get into something that you really like and then you see how much content there is, what a wonderful feeling.
Yeah.
What a wonderful feeling.
It's the gift that keeps on giving for sure. And I also think I've realized that like in an age where we're kind of at the end of the prestige television era and now there's a bunch of like fake prestige television shows that look really good until you hit play and then they're fine. Now that we've entered that era, what I have found is I am much, much more willing to dive headfirst into a reality competition where it's like, it's not pretending to be the second coming of True Detective or Game of Thrones. It's not pretending to be something incredible. It's exactly what it is. And that's just a bunch of people being messy and sometimes lying to each other. And that's great. And right now, my hyperfixation is firmly RuPaul's Drag Race.
Yeah, dude. Come on now.
I don't know why it took me so long to get here, except for the fact that I tend to gravitate towards physical competition a lot. I like to watch people playing games or, you know, racing each other or hitting each other or something like that. But oh my goodness, RuPaul's Drag Race is delivering all of the drama, all of the high stakes competitions. Like, it feels like if The Challenge and like a talent show had a baby.
Yeah. It's also, so, I just little side note here. Like please. A death drop is definitely physical. It is also it a is. Physical no, competition.
It is for sure. And I'm already, we're on our third season of watching it.
Now you get to appreciate this mug I got
That's
for Chelsea.
Such a good... Alyssa Edwards has a back very distinct rolls. Side profile. Dude, there's back roll references constantly. I mean, the show is so self-referential that it feels like the culture you're part of tight, an inside dude. Joke. The other Pork thing, chop. We started with season 5, which filmed in, I think, 2011. And something I've realized, Carter, you pointed it out to me beforehand. There is slang from the drag, from drag culture from 2011 that just became popular in like mainstream vernacular like last year. Drag yeah. is so, I can't figure out if drag is just ahead or if drag is like setting slang culture, but good grief, dude. Both. It's like so far ahead of what is happening in like mainstream. Yeah. It's crazy. And I feel like part of it is drag becoming mainstream too.
Yeah, 100%. And mine and Chelsea's experience of watching Drag Race in some of those early seasons when they were saying things like throwing shade and that's the tea. You know, like what's the tea? I was just like, wait a minute. It is, you do that like double take because Chelsea and I started with season 1 and I think it's totally fine if anybody wants to navigate RuPaul's Drag Race to start at season 5 because that is around the time that
five
like
is
square
a great
screen,
starting place.
Square screen becomes big screen. Yeah. But even
don't
then,
tell Zack Snyder.
Yeah. Even then it was like, oh my gosh. And RuPaul's Jordan, if you don't mind me coming in here to the hyperfixation station,
please.
It has been a joy for
this
me.
This is for everyone.
Jordan.
It's a one person train. It's one of those old little prospector carts that you have to pump.
almost every night since Jordan has begun this journey, he'll like text me, like I'm in bed. And I'm like, and I look, it's like, oh, cool. And we're just like kikiing about Drag Race. Sure. And, you know, we got into a conversation that I thought was really interesting. But really what makes a lot of these good reality shows in general, but these competitive reality shows is the host, right?
So oh, my goodness,
Jeff
dude.
Probst, we've talked about he's a counselor. He's a Sherpa. Like, he really is so perfect for Survivor. It does feel like if Probst is S tier, maybe RuPaul is S plus because in a very real way, RuPaul has more power in this competitive reality show than any other host.
Judge, jury, and executioner, dude, for sure.
But what's so crazy is it does feel like the culture of reality shows and just cult followings for shows in general, they're kind of looking for beef, like, hey, don't change a good thing. Like, you shouldn't have this much. And they're ready to just kind of like, you know, burn the house down. But nobody ever questions Rue.
No.
And Jordan brought it up, but it's like, because, I mean, this is like, I don't know, man. RuPaul has had as much influence on pop culture as what feels like the Beatles or something, to be honest. Like, especially for modern pop.
Well, you're the one who brought up to me that it's almost like if you audition for a singing competition and when you show up, the judge is the person who invented music. And it's like, oh, no.
Exactly.
It's like every time I find myself as a viewer when Rue delivers feedback to one of the queens and they push back, I'm like, who do you think you are right now? What are you doing?
Oh, and Rue's face, dude, I feel like I'm in trouble. Brutal. It's like when you're at school. I have to use a school reference because I have no siblings, but I would imagine it'd be the same. Like if your sibling's getting in trouble and you're just in the room and it's just like, if I stay still, they won't see me. It's just that same feeling. Also, when RuPaul gets tickled and starts laughing a lot, game over.
I'll tell you, I fell in love with the show. I have a moment with most of these shows where it finally clicks for me. Survivor, the big click for me, I think, with Survivor was the first Blindside that I saw. I was like, okay, this is everything I want to see forever. Big Brother, I think it was
season 20, there was just a lot of like funny speeches from somebody named Brett. And I was like, give me this all the time. Challenge was the first hall brawl. Amazing Race was the first time that somebody got U-turned and went home. It was all so great. But for Drag Race, the thing that hooked me was early in season 5, it's like 4 or 5 episodes in, they get to the lip sync battle at the very end of an episode. And both contestants just phone it in because they have horrible attitudes. And it finishes and Rue says, you both go home. Neither of you deserves to be here. You don't care about
sashay
this.
Sashay away.
And I was just like, oh, so, no pun intended, ruthless.
Yeah.
I love a host who cares so much that they are willing to be mean to keep the product good. Oh,
yeah.
It's everything I wanted.
If anybody's watching RuPaul because of the acclaim, because like, you know, it's successful. It's in its 16th season of like its original show. There's also RuPaul's All-Stars, Drag Race All-Stars. It does have a Survivor vibe, and I'm glad that we started with that. Nobody's really doing it, like looking up how many Emmys this has won, but I do want to share this. Yeah. RuPaul's Drag Race has 63 nominations over its run and 29 wins.
Wow,
it has almost 30 Emmy wins. And really, dude, a lot of these are going to Ru, like as host.
Totally makes sense to me.
And, you know, up against some of my favorites of like all time. Like I love, like y'all, Alan Cummings in Traitors right now is so wonderful. Mm-hmm. And I just love it. But
Alan's
RuPaul's
great.
Drag Race. If you have Paramount, that could be a place to see it. RuPaul's Drag Race is still kind of a lot of different places if you want to watch that. Where are y'all watching right now?
We're on the Paramount Plus app because season 5 was not on Paramount Plus through Amazon Prime. And I got a deal with the Big Brother live feeds for Paramount Plus. So we actually technically have 2 Paramount Plus subscriptions right now, but one of them is costing us like $2 a month. So we're hanging on to both subscriptions for now, but we're probably going to get rid of the one through Amazon Prime because the Paramount Plus app has more stuff. My final note on Drag Race is simply this: Bianca Del Rio forever.
Bianca.
I have a hard time imagining anybody dethroning Bianca for my favorite queen of all time. She's got it all. She has everything. She's cool. I want Bianca to hang out with me. Anyway, that's it for this installment of Hyperfixation Station. All off board, I suppose. Get off my train.
All off board.
that starts soon too.
Survivor or train?
You
that
decide.
Was a train.
That starts.
It's
that
Pikachu.
Starts soon.
Duh.
What is it? February 28th? Is that first episode?
I think
of
so.
New Survivor.
I think so.
Dude. Mike Bloom. He works for, I think it's Parade. I don't remember. But he also collaborates with Rob Cesternino, and Rob has a podcast, which is a great reality TV show podcast. If you need one in your life, but they just did a Survivor preview, and he got to go out to Fiji and sit with the new cast and interview all of them before the season. And he said that this is like. This cast is phenomenal, is what he said. Just so much personality. So I'm really excited.
Love it.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Very much so.
That's awesome. I feel like we're coming off a really strong cast too. Last season's cast was super strong.
D is my favorite winner in a long time. D and Jam Jam are like amazing winners.
Man, I love Jam Jam.
Yeah, I hope we keep that same winnergy for a while here.
Yeah.
Also, Jeff, it's time for a returner season. Let's go. Come on.
Yeah, miss those.
Like a new era's returners or some old vets too?
No, stop pretending 1 through 39 don't exist. There's tons of... If Kelly Wentworth comes back to that island, I'm going to lose my mind. It's time to start bringing back people that haven't played enough. We get it. It's the new era. Bring back old players. I'm excited.
Yep. And it's good because Traitors, it does feel like Traitors is getting to be a home for the ones that don't necessarily need to come back to Survivor anymore.
Yep.
Yeah.
But of course I want to see... Parvati in that role. Of course, I want to see Sari in that role.
Yeah.
Sandra. I can't believe Sandra. Anybody leaving Sandra on any kind of competitive show is the dumbest thing.
Yep. That's a mistake.
She's done it for decades now. What are you doing? She should not be here.
Get
rid of Sandra.
I'm one episode behind. I haven't watched last night's episode, but the fact that nobody is clocking Sandra as a high level threat is the key to her magic. That's the key to her magic. Yeah. That's what she does.
I don't know.
She's so unassuming, she and she will cut your throat, dude.
Bro, she means Sandra.
I hope so. I hope she's still playing that game. Because I'm honestly not clocking her as a high-level threat this season of Traitors.
Dude, she has this little gaggle of faithful around her as like this like force field barrier. They're listening to anything she says.
That's true. That's very true. We're going to talk about all this and they're going to banish her on last night's episode and we're going to have no idea.
Yeah, probably.
just missed it.
Probably. Actually, I do not think at all that's who's getting banned last night.
No, I don't think so either.
But I'll find out. I'm watching it tonight. Don't tell me. Don't tell me. Much like how I do with my general interest in things around me, now that I've talked about the thing that I like, the show's over.
I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm done
with finished.
This.
We're finished. Nobody else gets to say anything. We talked about my favorite thing, and that's plenty.
Please don't bring it up.
Thank you so much for joining us for this episode. We're so excited for this next year. Like, I have an energy around this podcast right now that we haven't felt in a while. It feels like fresh and new and like we're breaking new ground. We get to experiment and have some fun. And I think putting myself in the shoes of a listener, I think it's going to be a much more exciting year for Two Chunks. So make sure you stick around. Join us on Patreon and Discord so you can be a part of the behind the scenes fun. Check out the Teach Meech with us. Tooch Mooch is also fun. I think that's valid as well.
Can we get shirts with Stanley Tucci on them?
Sure.
If we do that?
I don't care.
We don't get in trouble for that?
I don't think Stanley Tucci is trademarked.
Likeness.
Is he trademarked?
Is he himself trademarked? I think I can. I'm going to just look up. Hang on.
Stanley Tucci TM.
Can I trademark Stanley Tucci then make him pay me?
Stanley Tucci, all rights reserved. Ooh,
that's the trick. Stanley Two Chunks.
Easy. Ooh.
Guys.
T-U-C-C-U-N-K-S. Stanley Two Chunks.
That's just totally
Guys,
ours.
I'm going to need you to check out that crispy link I sent. Whoa, that's a lot of letters for a link. I just sent it in the chat here.
Dang, dude, chill.
That's too much. I'm going to need you to check that out. We're going to have to get these if we become the Tooch Mooch.
Ooh.
That's pretty fresh, man.
That's pretty great.
I like it.
27% off for a limited time?
I like it.
I can't lose money on this. I got to get it now.
Dang. Who knew? Well, anyway, this has been Two Chunks. Thank you for listening. How do we want to end these?
You decide, dude.
Same as always.
To end an episode, we say our name and something.
I need you to give me your name and then do some stuff. Just some stuff.
Some
like it's just always
thing,
just like.
Oh, I got
stuff.
It. I got it. For two chunks. I'm gonna need everybody to give me your name and what your drag name would be. Keep in mind
I'm googling extremely powerful drag names. Nice. 1 second.
I gotta say I still am having a hard time finding a funnier like I love names that sound like real names, and in season 5 the first one we watched there was somebody named Coco Montrese, which is just like a regular name.
Yeah, that's really
and
good
and I love it so much. It's such a good name. For Two Junks and a Hunk, my name is Jordan Wonders and my drag name would be Uranus Neptune.
Very good.
My anus? I'm Doge, and I went to a website on the internet.
Generator?
It's called the Official Drag Name Generator.
Yeah, good.
And the first one that it gave me is the one I'm taking for myself, and that is Terry Aki.
Oh, I like that.
That's pretty fun.
There was one named Penetration, which I liked quite a bit.
That's so good.
My second favorite Carter. Of the show is Alaska something I can't say.
Thunder expletive.
Mm-hmm.
I'm Carter. And what there's going to be... Are you on any seasons yet that are unedited?
No, not yet. It's all still bleak.
You'll get some. There's going to be some that you do, and it's what it's meant to be.
I'm excited.
For real, dude.
I'm really excited.
Charisma, uniqueness, nerve, and talent.
Yeah.
I'm Carter, and I will be known as Hardly Nowhere.
Oh, yeah.
Hardly.
Dang, dude. Have you thought about this
That's
before?
That's really good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's really good.
Yeah.
All right. Well, till next time. Give us your clicks.
Give us the clicks.
Just click them. Just click on it. Just click on it.
It's one click it.
Yeah, just click
give them.